According to the tradition of this university, we start the ceremony with a prayer. Spiritu Sancti Gratia, illumina sensus et corda nostra. Please take your seats. Welcome everyone here in the hall of the University of Nijmegen, where Mrs. Tunjungputri will defend her thesis in a few minutes. My name is Paul Stout. I'm a retired internist. I was professor here at the university, and now you have the honor to replace the rector. At this time, that is Professor van Krieken, for this kind of ceremonies. A special welcome for everyone, especially those who come from very far, and for the guests far abroad who look to the ceremony with a special digital connection. First, in the we start with the floor for the promovenda.
With the permission of the Council of Deans and in order to obtain the degree of doctor from Radboud University in Nijmegen, I would like to defend in public my doctoral thesis entitled Platelets in Infectious Diseases, the Silent Force. Platelets are small anucleate cells which are abundant in the circulation. Platelets are mostly known for their function in hemostasis, and that is blood clotting. So platelet would form an aggregate and then form a plug to help stop bleeding. However, humans have 10 times more platelets than required for this function alone. Recent evidence points that platelets are participating actively in host defense. Therefore, platelets affect infection and inflammation, and this is mainly achieved through the platelet interaction directly with invading pathogens, or because platelet release mediators that can help platelets to communicate with effector cells of inflammation. We try to investigate how platelet can influence the inflammation or immunity by studying this in the 500 FG cohort, which is a cohort consisting of 500 healthy volunteers as part of the Human Functional Genomics Project here in Nijmegen. We measure platelet reactivity, and that is measure of platelet function. And at the same time, cytokine responses to a range of different stimuli were also measured. And then we could look at this interaction between platelet function and inflammation. One cytokine in particular, IL-1, is an important driver of inflammation. Platelets contain IL-1 beta, and we found that platelet counts are associated with plasma IL-1 beta levels. This seems to suggest that platelets are a major source of IL-1 beta in the circulation, and this has never been reported before. Furthermore, platelets interact directly with immune cells. They are able to bind and therefore communicate with immune cells. This interaction leads to activation, also changes in the inflammatory traits and behavior of both types of cells when they interact with each other. Also from the 500 FG cohort, we found that platelet function is associated with a range of cytokine responses to different bacterial or synthetic stimuli. Platelet function is associated with cytokine responses, and this further highlights the interrelatedness of platelet function and inflammation. In chapter 3, we reported how platelets can modulate inflammatory responses. We found that platelets downregulate the secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokine when stimulated with when mononuclear cells are stimulated with pamthrosis, which is a toll-like receptor 2 ligand. TLR2 is a major receptor for recognition of most gram-positive bacteria. In the opposite, we found that platelet upregulate the mononuclear cell cytokine responses upon stimulation with LPS, a TLR4 agonist, which is a major recognition receptor for most gram-negative bacteria. We also reported that platelet inhibition, which is mediated by these drugs that are especially used in cardiovascular diseases can then result in pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory changes based on the types of stimuli. On the other hand, infection and inflammation can also alter platelet function. In the context of infectious diseases, the coagulation system have been widely studied, and this is because measuring coagulation, plasmatic coagulation, is relatively easier because you can do it retrospectively on stored samples, whereas the data for platelet function is still lacking because it requires immediate measurement out of these diseased patients. We work with our collaborators in Utrecht Medical Center using a whole blood flow cytometry-based assay to measure platelet function. So platelet function can either be upregulated, and that is associated with increased cardiovascular diseases, or it can be downregulated, and that is associated with bleeding. Infectious diseases might lead to these two extremes of complications. We therefore studied and found that platelet reactivity is increased in different diseases, such as pneumococcal disease, which we studied in a porcine model, in gram-positive sepsis, as well as HIV patients. These diseases are associated already with increased cardiovascular diseases or thrombotic vascular events. On the other hand, we found decreased platelet reactivity when we were looking at leptospirosis patients. Leptospirosis is a disease caused by the bacteria Leptospira enterogens, which leads to bleeding as one of its major complications. And it is platelet function rather than platelet count that is related to the bleeding complications in these patients. This brings me to the end of my introduction, that platelets are important in inflammation and immune responses. The modulating effects of platelets on inflammation depend on the types of stimuli that they encounter. And last, infections alter platelet function, and this contributes to infectious disease complications. Having presented this summary of my doctoral thesis, I return the floor to the rector.
Thank you for this introduction. A few words about the ceremony today. The candidate has prepared a thesis under the guidance of the two promoters and the co-promoter, that are Professor van der Ven, Professor Ghazem from Diponegoro University in Indonesia, Semarang, and the co-promoter, Dr. De Mast. Under their supervision, the candidate has made the thesis, and they have discussed a lot already with the candidate, so they ask no questions today. And next to these three, there is the first opponent, that is Professor Semple. He is his professorship is transfusion medicine. He is from Lund University, Sweden. Welcome from very far here. And he was also a member of the reading committee. And the reading committee is the committee who saw the manuscript a few weeks ago already, so they approved that the thesis could be defended today. The floor is to Professor Semple.
Thank you very much, Madam Candidate. Good morning. So I just want to first say that I want to commend you. I read the thesis and I enjoyed reading it, and I must commend you on quite an impressive body of work with 9 research chapters and 6 first authored, published or in press papers. That's quite commendable. So I thought what I would do is, because there's so many chapters, I don't think I can ask you questions on every chapter, so I thought I'd pick a few that sort of are in my realm anyways. And I guess just to break the ice, you talk about toll-like receptors and these funny receptors that are on platelets. Can you just give me a brief description of the primordial toll-like receptor and what it looks like and perhaps some uniqueness about its structure?
Honored, sir. Thank you for your question. You traveled some distance. Thank you. So toll-like receptor 1-9. Platelets have been found to possess these receptors. So they are present either on the surface of platelets or as well as intracellularly. Now, what's really interesting is that platelets are not able to produce this machinery themselves. What happens is they possess RNA, which is then translated to produce all the mature functional machinery of the cells. It is then very, very interesting that platelets already kind of primordially own this, even when they're still megakaryocytes.
So what do the toll-like receptors look like?
Well, they are. They have a pattern recognition that can recognize either the pathogen molecular pattern or damaged molecular pattern.
Is there something unique about their amino acid structure? Or somewhat unique, I should say. Do they have a particular shape? Antibodies have a Y shape when you look at them. Do toll-like receptors have any kind of shape?
They can dimerize.
That's right. Well, they dimerize.
That's one thing.
Yes. They have to dimerize, don't
so,
they?
Yeah. So when discussing, for example, toll-like receptor 2, we cannot exclusively say toll-like receptor 2, for example, but must say toll-like receptor 1, 2. Dimerization.
So they shape like U's, and when they dimerize, they actually shape like a W, and that's what allows them to signal, right? Mm-hmm. And what's the major pathway they signal through?
For example, NF-kappa beta,
and
translocation.
MYD88. Do platelets have MYD88?
Yeah.
Yeah, they do. So then, just really quickly, you suggested that platelets have all the machinery. They have messenger RNA and they can translate their proteins. Do they do this, or is it the megakaryocytes that give them that ability?
I know that, for example, the maturation from pro-I1 beta to I1 beta, that is something that is only occurring once there's an activation signal for both megakaryocytes and platelets. Some of these machineries are already operative at the megakaryocyte stage. So megakaryocytes also perform a lot of functions that's rather similar already to mature platelet. For example, they can also have P-selectin expression on their surface.
Yeah, so the prevailing thought now is that it's the megakaryocyte that dictates what the platelets will do. So if you stress a megakaryocyte, Andy Weyrich, for example, in Utah, has done this with infectious particles, either gram-negative or gram-positive. The molecular genetics that those megakaryocytes undergo will be transferred to the platelets. And so it's a way of the megakaryocytes of disseminating their responses through platelets into the periphery.
Yep.
So that's important to remember. Everything you look at with a platelet, you might want to think about what happens in the bone marrow with megakaryocytes, or the lung, as we just learned that the lung is a major site. A little bit about chapter 3 and the in vitro work. So you took peripheral blood mononuclear cells.
Indeed.
And so these were density gradient generated, Percol,
yeah.
Ficol.
So
in a PBMC population, what do we have? Four types of basic leukocytes. What are they?
So neutrophils, we have monocytes,
no,
we
you
have
don't
lymphocytes.
Have
in PBMC, you mean?
PBMCs.
PBMCs, we would have monocytes.
Monocytes
have
is one.
B cell.
B cells.
T cells.
T cells. One other.
And dendritic cells.
Well, perhaps. Natural killer cells.
Yeah.
So mostly lymphocytes, a little bit of monocytes. So you put them into culture and then you add bacterial stimuli and you look at cytokine responses, interferon gamma and mm-hmm. interleukin 1 beta. And then you add platelets. So the question I have, I may have missed it, were the platelets that you added, were they autologous platelets or heterologous platelets?
They are heterologous.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then the question becomes, in these cultures, just as a mechanistic point of view from the interferon gamma response, where is that interferon gamma coming from when you stimulate with these bacterial
T cells? Likely.
Well, could it come source. From anywhere else? Well, it could come from all of those cell types. Even monocytes
yeah.
have now been shown to make small
to
amounts of interferon gamma. But it's thought that T cells and natural killer cells are really the major source of interferon gamma. So now the fact that the platelets are heterologous, what does that do in terms of how a T cell might see a platelet?
Well, that introduced another factor that is a foreign antigen. It could be that through Fc gamma receptor that some factors are introduced, and therefore...
The T cells, how do they recognize their ligand? They have a T cell receptor. Mm-hmm. And what do they see?
Platelet, that's not autologous.
MHC class 1 and MHC class 2, right?
Yeah.
So if we think about platelets, what's their makeup with regards to the MHC?
So they have either surface MHC1 or they have intracellular MHC1.
Right.
And this would lead them to be able to tune with the adaptive responses of the T cells as well.
So is there a major difference between the surface MHC and the intracellular MHC that platelets have?
So the interesting part is that it kind of mimics what we saw with monocytes, that platelets can either be pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. So for the surface MHC1, these are tend to lead to inhibition of the T cell response, whereas the intracellular MHC1 leads to activation or upregulation of the T cell response.
Can you cite some literature that supports
your
that?
Your work is obviously heavily relying on that.
I wasn't even going for that one, but so that's right. So that the surface MHC on platelets is denatured; it gets absorbed from the plasma, where they have intact MHC in their alpha granules. So when a denatured MHC molecule hits a T cell receptor, mm-hmm. what do you think happens?
Platelets can act in more in a thrombotic direction or immunological direction. One of the mediators
that's
important is...
No, that wasn't the question I asked. I asked, what would a T cell do if it met up with the denatured MHC class 1 molecule on platelets?
It gets activated.
Are you sure?
It can respond differently, just like what we just discussed. You can have interaction with CD8 cells, for example, can be responding to the stimulation. You can also have, dendritic cell, but that's not the T cell exclusively. But CD8 cells are then
they
responding.
They get inhibited by them. By the surface MHC.
Yeah.
And so you show in these in on page 27 in this graph that when you add in, for example, S. aureus, you get a fairly robust interferon gamma response. And then when you add these heterologous platelets, you get an inhibition, which is absolutely fine. I have no issues with that. So do you want to think about the mechanism of how you get the inhibition? Because we know that the interferon gamma is either coming from the T cells or probably the natural killer cells that are there.
Yeah, so with regards to especially interferon gamma, one literature has already reported that, for example, platelet microparticles, by transferring their content, are able to change the differentiation of T cells less into the T helper 17 and into the interferon gamma producing cells. And this might be one way, because this experiment have been replicated in different contexts, different stimuli, and this seems to be something that's more related to the interferon gamma pathway or the interferon gamma producing cells rather than the type of stimuli.
One more?
Okay.
Perhaps a
second round. Okay. Thank you, Professor Semple. Thank you for coming to Nijmegen, and thank you for your membership of the reading committee. Another member of the reading committee, and now for the opposition, is Dr. Nazil. He is an internist hematologist affiliated to the Radboud University Medical Center. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Prorector. First, my congratulations on your thesis, and thank you for me having reading it and enjoying it. It's on a very interesting subject of the role of platelets in infectious disease, and especially the hypercoagulability is always intriguing. It has many similarities with hypercoagulability in for example, cancer patients or other diseases. And as a clinician, I'm interested in the clinical implications, as you state in chapter 11 on page 223. And my first question is a more holistic question. This is a reaction of nature. It happens in infections, it happens in malignancies. Do you think this is a reaction the body needs? Is it beneficial or is it non-beneficial? Is it detrimental? What do you think of that? And try to explain why you think that.
Yeah, honored sir. Yes, this is, on the one hand, is something I think that the body utilizes to be able to control the entire immunity or inflammation response better. As we know, platelet is much more abundant cells compared to the professional immune cells. They are able to circulate, and due to their small size, they are able to penetrate maybe areas that are more difficult for leukocytes in general. Literature seem to suggest that platelets is tending to be more beneficial for the body, but I think it's different regarding the literature that we found. For example, depletion of platelet is associated with higher mortality in sepsis patients or in mice. It seems to suggest that on the one hand, platelets is beneficial, for example, in entrapment and elimination of pathogens. When they are activated, they are able to surround pathogens, and that will eventually be sequestered by the liver. On the other hand, pathogens themselves can hijack this process and hide from the immune cells by hiding within a platelet thrombi. We know from infective endocarditis that platelets are involved, but then the bacteria is not being able to be penetrated by immune cells in general. So I think this is a double-edged sword, whereas a properly regulated platelet responses that is well synchronized with the inflammation response is then able to assist inflammation whichever direction they need to go. So if pro-inflammatory means defense, then that is a
so you a suggest well there will be a balance between beneficial and non-beneficial effects.
Yes.
Because that's exactly the same in malignancies in which circulating tumor cells hijack this system and do exactly the same.
Yeah.
And then my second question is, why do you then inhibit the system of the platelets with medication, thrombocyte aggregation inhibiting? Because then the balance will be maybe in the wrong way.
Yeah.
Why do you suggest that will work?
Yeah, so this is where our work have become extremely important. People have looked at abnormalities in the coagulation system during infection or inflammation, but no one has ever really studied platelet as an entity of function. So that's what we did exactly. We want to know whether platelet responses are upregulated or not during some different inflammation and infection. And from those studies, we know that, for example, in pneumonia, in HIV, and in gram-positive sepsis, platelets are hyperreactive. This already shows the dysregulation. These hyperreactive platelets are then potentially increasing or amplifying the inflammatory responses of the immune cells, and therefore they might participate in damaging the tissue.
So you try to inhibit the inflammatory response by inhibiting the platelets, that's what you say.
Yeah, that might be one mechanism.
Yeah, exactly. Those medications in malignancies, in circulating tumor cells, in which the hypothesis was exactly the same, did not improve anything. Why do you believe it will improve in this disease?
Yeah, so we might be, of course, I'm not in the expertise area of tumors.
I know.
But in the context of inflammation in general, platelets, as we found, can either be pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. Now, they have a very exaggerating effect, or they can have a dampening effect. Now, from the animal studies, we know that, for example, in an arthritic mice model, is giving antiplatelet is actually increasing inflammation.
Yes.
Whereas in the more typical studies with LPS injection, it decreases inflammatory responses. But these studies did exactly what we are doing. They haven't looked at it in the perspective that we are doing, and that is looking at which kind of invading pathogens they encounter or what sort of ligand are activated. And this is actually a very important determinant of which direction platelets are going. Yeah. Patient studies also show conflicting results, mortality-wise, acute lung injury incidents, kidney injury.
So
also,
it's more complex than only platelets, because the coagulation systems consist of many things, from Willebrand factor, all the plasma coagulation activities.
Yeah, well, although platelet is an important amplifier, we must say that these studies are all mostly retrospective studies, or looking at those patients who have been on chronic long-term antiplatelet therapy, rather than having a good prospective study on the effect of antiplatelets.
Do you think that the genetics of the patient has to do with the outcome?
First, there are the very common genetic factors of antiplatelet in the human body as well. For example, we know that clopidogrel depends on this polymorphism, which can either show a good response to the drug or intermediate or very low response to the drug. That's one way to look at it in relation to the drugs. But we also know from the study from the Human Functional Genomics Project that polymorphism or genetic makeup is already considered to determine individually inflammation response. It has been determined to influence platelet function, but now we know it's probably a bit more complicated than that, because what we found is that there is shared genetic regulatory mechanisms that regulates both inflammation and platelet function at the same time, and this has never been looked at before. So it can be there's the same leader for the orchestra, which is at the same time working on different machineries of the body.
What do you think the future will be in this field? Genetics determine the treatment, genetic determine the reaction. What do you think the future will be?
I think it's a very important mix of, in terms of genetics, we can say from my study on the invasive pneumococcal disease that even the genetics makeup of the bacteria can determine platelet responses. But taking into account genetic alone would be quite challenging, because let's say sepsis, for example, that is very heterogeneous disease. It's very difficult to know the course and the progression of the disease. So what will happen is, I think we will see a genomic profile of a certain patient and then have a very quick scan of the genome of the bacteria. Mm-hmm. And then,
if you ask my opinion, it's the genetics of the bacteria, the genetics of the patients, and there will be a personalized treatment for those patients. And the one you treat with certain medication and the other with other.
Yeah.
Those were my questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Nezil, for your questions. The next opponent is from abroad, from Utrecht University. Very far abroad, no, not too far, but it is not Nijmegen. Professor de Groot, his professorship is biochemistry of thrombosis and hemostasis.
Thank you
for coming. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. First, I want to start with to congratulate you with your thesis. It's very nice work, and I want to include also your promoters and your co-promoter with my congratulations. I would like to start the discussions with you about in chapter 10, the leptospirosis study. In this study, you see that patients have a low platelet count, and in your study, you suggest that this low platelet count is due to the fact that von Willebrand factor in the circulation starts to bind to the platelets, and it is for Willebrand factor is a signal for the platelets to clear it from the circulation. And in your conclusion, in your abstract, you suggest that a novel anti-for Willebrand factor therapy might be beneficial for these patients. What I want to know is how you start to convince an ethical committee to treat a patient with a severe bleeding tendency with an anti-for Willebrand factor therapy.
Honored, sir. So these patients indeed are classified as severe leptospirosis patients. We even categorize them as bleeders and non-bleeders. What makes our study is very, very crucial in this is that we have this very, very good technique developed by an institution where you worked, is that we were able to measure exactly first baseline platelet activation and second platelet responsiveness to different agonists. And it has become important because we know, for example, there's a very, very limited sensitivity in measuring platelet function using the old technique, and that is light transmission aggregometry. Now, the advantage of our technique is that we know exactly, for example, that there's higher platelet activation at baseline, and that leads to secondary platelet dysfunction. Using anti-von Willebrand factor here would mean that platelet function would be inhibited, and indeed, we did see platelet activation is increased at baseline. So we only saw bleeding due to the secondary effect of this heightened activation at baseline. You are correct in that convincing the ethical committee is going to be very tricky, but must also say that if increased baseline platelet activation is associated with a more thrombotic tendency of platelets, then it would make perfect sense to inhibit this process. And anyway, patients are going to be treated with antibiotics, and what we are doing here is preventing the development of complications that might occur to these patients.
But don't you think that if you give this antifibrillant antibody, it will bleed anyhow?
It will, sorry?
Patients will bleed anyhow because you block the fibrillant factor function.
Well, if we can prevent the heightened platelet activation at baseline, that would have beneficial effects. For example, prevention, if indeed our speculation is correct, that it would prevent the sequestration of platelets von Willebrand factor complex by the liver, and that would lead to the preserved state of not only platelet function, but also platelet number in the circulation, and that would stop it from developing into a secondary platelet dysfunction.
Are there also alternatives thinkable? Other ways of treatment?
Well, from the perspective of just what platelets do systemically in general, we also did research on recombinant alkaline phosphatase in sepsis patients, and they were found to be able to improve the improve outcome in acute kidney injury patients that is induced by sepsis, and in leptospirosis in particular. Acute kidney injury can develop, and that is another option for treatment.
Okay, but I was thinking, I will come back to the alkaline phosphatase if I have time enough, but why don't you think that, why you focus on von Willebrand factor, why not focusing on glycoprotein 1b?
Well, as mentioned in my paper, it's also possible to either block the binding site of von Willebrand factor on the von Willebrand factor site, or you can also block its binding receptor, and that is GP1B. So these mechanisms are both present. Binding GP1B specifically in platelet is also a very good treatment option.
Have you checked whether glycoprotein 1B binds directly to the leptospirosis?
With regards to leptospirosis, it's a bit limited data on what they do, because leptospira is a very unique pathogen that have both TLR2 and TLR4. And in mice and humans, data are still incomplete about that.
Because glycoprotein 1b is a member of the toll-like receptor family. So it also recognizes patterns. So maybe it has also an interaction with these pathogens.
Very interesting input. We'll try to look at it that way.
Okay, then coming back to alkaline phosphatase, there's a very nice studies. In your study in which you use alkaline phosphatase, the concentration you use is 50 units per ml. How's that compared to the plasma concentration?
It's higher than the, physiological.
Higher than physiological? How much?
Approximately 10 times.
So it is quite much higher.
Yeah.
Have you ever studied whether alkaline phosphatase on its own is a regulator of platelet function?
I'm sorry, can you repeat
that? Have you ever checked whether plasma alkaline phosphatase is a regulator of platelet function? Because the level of alkaline phosphatase in your body can change.
That is true, but if we are thinking about a physiological level of alkaline phosphatase,
and liver disease,
it
can
would
be extremely
probably
high.
Yeah, and we also know that in liver disease, platelet can be dysregulated and have lower function. and leads to bleeding complication, but I think that also has to do with a lot of disruption of coagulation factor disruption.
In liver disease, platelets are more active than in healthy control. So that is exactly the opposite. Therefore, I'm wondering whether alkaline phosphatase can be a good regulator, because in liver disease, it's more active.
That is one option, but the problem is with looking at whether platelets are increased in function or lower in function is, again, we are always considering platelet inhibition and whether it would, you know, lead to bleeding, because there would already be secondary platelet dysfunction that occur because of that heightened basal activation. So I think there's too little known at the moment, but indeed therapeutic options can be going different directions.
And thinking of a third therapeutic option is maybe using adam-TIA13 as a therapeutic option. Have you thought about that?
Yeah, so, in our study, it depends. If you have a more abundant adam-TIA13 as a compensation mechanism already for the higher von Willebrand factor, then perhaps that's just more of a defense or more of a compensation mechanism. Unless you have an innate disease where adam-TIA13 is already depleted or non-existent.
Well, the adam-TIA13 was quite low in leptospirosis.
That is one thing. Although looking at just the physiological events that's happening in leptospirosis, it does not lead to the extent that there is thrombotic complications. So it seems to be sequestration. We don't know whether it's more related to endothelial cell lining interaction between platelet von Willebrand factor, or this is happening in the circulation where these complexes are circulating and then removed by the liver. So I guess that's how we thought that blocking platelet von Willebrand factor interaction would be the first line to go in the future.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor De Groot, and thank you for coming to Nijmegen. The next opponent is Professor Pickers. He is professorship is experimental intensive care medicine. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Rector. Dear candidate, I also want to congratulate you with the finishing of your very nice booklet with different chapters that are really interesting, and I want to congratulate your promoters and co-promoter as well. But as you know, I also have to ask some critical stuff, and I want to focus on chapter 3. And I think it's important always to try to find the logic or the reason why some results are what they are. And my first question is, and it's maybe also from an evolutionary standpoint, why would it be that if you add platelets and you stimulate with a toll-like receptor 1 and 2 ligand compared to a toll-like receptor 4 ligand, you see opposite effects?
Arnold, sir. Gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria is really what we see this represents as. So these are very two distinct cell wall components of the bacteria. We know, for example, from different mice studies and basic studies that LPS is not a strong inducer of platelet activation. Also, on the other hand, gram-positive have been widely studied in their propensity to induce platelet aggregation as well as platelet activation and degranulation. So from this physiological point of view, it's also that when platelet gets more activated, they tend to aggregate more, they tend to be able to form this thrombus that then blocks the platelet, blocks the bacteria, and kind of entrap them. It might be that this kind of primitive response is actually more crucial for the gram-positive bacteria. For some reason, yeah, I think.
So it's just by luck that the one bacteria has this effect and the other one, and there's no really a benefit for the host?
Or actually humans are being tricked by the bacteria, because we know that they can hide in the septic thrombus as well, and that's how they can hide from the immune system. So this is what we know, and then you would have indeed, on the other hand, a detrimental effect for the humans when these complications occur, higher chances of microvascular thrombosis, infective endocarditis and such.
All right. And then if we go to the intervention with the ticagrelor that you studied, then you also see opposite effects depending on what ligand you use. So what would be the mechanism of action that the same drug does the opposite things?
Yeah, I think we have to go back to the basic study, and that is looking at the platelet function itself. So when we're talking about upregulated of the inflammatory responses, studies have shown that there's nuclear translocation of NF-kappa beta, and that would lead to higher responses of these cytokine release and cytokine production. We are also, when talking about the downregulation of the pro-inflammatory cytokines, we are, for example, in our study, we showed that gram-positive bacterial ligand, PAM3-CIS, leads to a higher platelet monocyte complex formation and also phagocytosis of the platelets by the monocytes. And these phagocytoses are not a singular process. It can lead to either internalization of the toll-like receptors on the surface of the monocytes, or it can lead to, as had been reported in other studies, lead to the consumption or transfer of RNA, which then kind of regulate the downstream processes. So platelets actually introduce RNAs into the monocytes.
So the effect of the drug on the platelet reactivity, is that the main driver, do you think, or is that not so important?
Well, there can be two things, especially in view of ticagrelor. Of course, it on the one hand can inhibit platelet ADP signaling, which is an important amplifier of platelet activation pathway. In that sense, that inhibits the degranulation of platelets, which would lead to expression of P-selectin, etc. Those are blocked by ticagrelor. On the other hand, we also know that ticagrelor is also functioning through inhibition of adenosine reuptake, and that would introduce to more anti-inflammatory secondary effect to the monocytes. So indeed, by introducing these drugs, we are not fully aware that we're just blocking platelet function, but this is indeed what is clinically relevant. So, because of course we separate platelet from monocytes by using transwell in the lab, but I think we cannot deplete humans from platelets.
Okay, and so if we look at another platelet aggregation inhibitor, aspirin, do you know what the effects are of chronic aspirin use on the inflammatory response?
So aspirin has been studied also for their wide effects due to their inhibition of the cyclooxygenase. In terms of patient studies, also results are a bit conflicting. They are able to reduce systemic inflammation upon chronic use, but results in patients are conflicting. Some found that there's benefits from reduced mortality in patients. Others do not see the same effects.
But there have been some studies in which they injected endotoxin to healthy volunteers, and so they use that as a human model of inflammation. And there, you know, they have studied the effects of aspirin, and 7-day use of low dose aspirin increased the pro-inflammatory cytokines. And while the very high dosage of aspirin at the moment of LPS administration had no effect, so it's counterintuitive. Probably, but aspirin indeed has an increasing effect on the pro-inflammatory cytokines. All right, so do you think, so if overall we say that the ticagrelor has a dampening effect on LPS-induced immune suppression, and there is some, so the PLATO trial, for example, in which these drugs were tested in human patients, in cardiovascular patients, they found that mortality was lower in the active treatment group, especially from pneumonia and sepsis.
Yeah.
And this makes it interesting, right? So what do you think is beneficial to the host, to dampen the immune response by a drug such as this, or to have an activated immune response?
I think early to have an activated immune response is a good thing for the body. So early in the process, of course, you need host defense. In the early stage of pathogen encounter, that's how platelets are preserved in humans with their immune properties, because they are needed in the function of defending the body from these invading pathogens assisting in that. But once the body developed this dysregulation of the systemic inflammation, and that has become the role of platelet in, so the role of platelets in that sense then are becoming more crucial as the cells that are present abundantly to then amplify the response and therefore increasing the chance of tissue damage because of having a heightened inflammatory response. Or then on the other hand, maybe we can tweak them into a more kind of a dampening this overly active damaging inflammatory response.
Okay, thank you very much. This was the long answer. The short answer is it's complex. And with that, I give the word back to you.
Thank you, Professor Pickers. The next opponent is Professor Smith. He is professor in internal medicine. The floor is yours, Professor Smith.
Thank you very much, Rector. Madam Candidate, I would like to congratulate you on your excellent thesis, also the promoters and co-promoter. And for me, it was very much worthwhile to read your thesis because it was a postgraduate course on thrombocyte metabolism for free. So I learned a lot. Thank you for that. I would like to discuss with you also on chapter 3. And in chapter 3, you formulate a complex equation containing platelets, PBMCs, TICA galore, and toll-like receptors 2 and 4, and all in the context of patients with increased cardiovascular risk using those drugs. And as an endocrinologist, I'm interested in diets, and we know that subjects with increased cardiovascular risk tend to have diets rich in saturated fatty acids. And we know that saturated fatty acids like palm oil or comparable compounds are very strong toll-like receptor 4 stimulants. And could you speculate on the effects of an diet rich in fatty in saturated fatty acids on the equation? So how would this influence the interaction between platelets and PBMCs?
Honored sir, we have never exclusively looked at saturated fatty acid in interaction with platelets. We know from our study in the 500 FG cohort that there is no association between heightened platelet function with, for example, obesity or body mass index.
Sorry, it's just not what you have studied. I realize that you do not have studied this, but it's just to speculate in the context of the experiments in chapter 3 what saturated fatty acids would do in your experimental setup.
Yeah, I think because this experimental setup is rather isolating for the platelets. They are a bit lonely there. They are missing all the environments that are normally present in the circulation. We know platelets exert a lot of their effects through their interaction with professional immune cells. They are more of the assistant. Here we have monocytes, but I think when you are giving something that would induce toll-like receptor 4, and that is in our study, is not leading to very high platelet activation, it does not lead to high platelet degranulation, and therefore, I guess it would be that platelet is not a major determinant of increased inflammatory profiles when you introduce saturated fatty acid.
Put it more simply, if you would replace LPS in your experiments with palm oil, what would be the outcome of the experiment then?
I think that would depend largely on what it does to the mononuclear cells in isolation, but my guess is that platelet will not really lead to an increased pro-inflammatory cytokine profile production by these cells, as had been shown for the toll-like receptor 4.
Mm-hmm. you don't think there is much of an effect, but would you expect that it is interesting to study this in your in vitro model?
Indeed. I think when introducing a factor such as saturated fatty acid, it's important to keep in mind that it's probably you do not see an effect from the saturated fatty acid to the platelets, but if you first introduce saturated fatty acid into the mononuclear cells, and there are some changes there, maybe that would change the way monocytes are interacting with platelets in terms of which receptors they use to bind to each other, in terms of which process go one after the other. That might matter. So, yeah, I think that would be the only thing into consideration for that.
Well, the opposite would be the diet that we advise to patients, polyunsaturated fatty acids, which are toll-like receptor 2 stimulants. But I will skip that speculation. Is there room for another short question?
A short question, please, and a short answer.
Okay. Well, this is about chapter 4, also a very nice chapter. And I was just wondering, out of my lack of knowledge on this field, where you do the experiments with alkaline phosphatase and the molecule P-selectin. I looked up in the old literature and I noticed that P-selectin is also phosphorylated at different sites. And I was just wondering if adding alkaline phosphatase to a system in which you study P-selectin expression could not lead to dephosphorylation of P-selectin itself and thereby introduce some bias in the experiments that you read out. Would that be possible?
So indeed, the way that we perform this experiments, of course, this is a work that's largely based on ex vivo experiments. If we are doing it in a way that is more relevant clinically, then what happened is we introduce alkaline phosphatase more as a prevention strategy. So we actually put in first the alkaline phosphatase before we stimulate the platelets. And you are correct that if at that point the dephosphorylation already starting to occur, not only to the adenosine dephosphate, but also to the platelet P-selectin, then that might be a bias. But on the other hand, we also know that P-selectin is one of the most abundant mediators that is present in the alpha granule, and also alpha granule is the most abundant granule in the platelet. They are the major regulator of the platelet activation pathway of platelets. So if I were to speculate, I think the contribution of such process is probably negligible, and also we are using a control in our experiments. But indeed, that is a factor to consider.
Okay,
that
thank
we
you
miss.
Very much.
Thank you, Professor Schmidt. The next opponent is Professor Wertheim. Professor Wertheim is professor in microbiology at our university. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Director. Dear candidate, I also was very impressed by your thesis, and I want to congratulate you and your supervisors. I'm supposed to actually replace Professor De Groot, who's a professor in pediatrics, and actually I'm a clinical microbiologist, so maybe the kind of questions you'll expect will be very different. But I do want to start with thrombocytes, actually, and maybe start a bit philosophical. There are billions of them are made every day by the megakaryocytes, and they only live like 8 days. They don't have a nucleus. So just a philosophical question, are platelets actually really cells?
Well, that is kind of almost threatening my own existence, but yes, they are cells because they are able to translate and then therefore independently can also have these proteins expressed and released. So I think that is an entity of a fully functional cell.
I was sort of expecting that answer, and the megakaryocytes play an important role, also probably in infectious disease. Do you know of any studies of looking at sepsis and the role of megakaryocytes and how they influence platelets? Because that's something that you did not touch on, and Professor Semple briefly touched on it. I just want to see if you can elaborate a little bit more on that.
Yeah, well, megakaryocytes is indeed the precursor of platelet, and I think there's a lot of studies that are done exclusively ex vivo on megakaryocytes and introducing different TLR ligands. But in this sense, I am not aware of such study. Could be my own limitation in the literature. But what I can speculate is that indeed megakaryocytes is present in the environment of hematopoiesis, and all sorts of cytokines are participating in the increased production of mature platelets from megakaryocyte, including IL-6, IL-1 alpha, IL-1 beta. And I presume that as long as the environment is induced to produce these factors that would then alter megakaryopoiesis, then it's highly possible that functional changes are already occurring in megakaryocytes.
Thank you. I mean, there has been a very nice study looking that saw that messenger RNA is differently expressed by the role of megakaryocytes. I can give you the paper later on. Just for my understanding, you have done a lot of essays, and in chapter 2 you've done it in 500 healthy volunteers. Was it one time point measurement, or how many blood samples did you test per?
Yeah, we only did one time measurement, so that is also the case for the cytokine data that we are using in the current work.
So if you would do the same patient the next day, would you get the same result?
Platelet function has been reported to be stable over time within persons if we are using the same technique, and it also has been shown to be rather reliable in a sense that if you repeat over even a longer period, that they would show the same profile. And this kind of fits with the fact that, of course, there's a lot of genetic makeup that determines platelet responses, apart from the environmental effects.
And the assays themselves, are they also quite robust?
This is actually the assay that is now, we are relying heavily upon, because this assay is able to then look at the expression of different receptors, activation markers on platelet, and we do not manipulate the sample, which is different from just platelet aggregation tests often used in the clinic, because that would isolate platelet from the whole blood, that would introduce mechanical stress to the platelet, and that alone is leading to platelet activation. But in our assay, yes, it's a very good assay, and we read the platelet as they are from the body. We have very strict protocols.
Well, thank you for this crash course in platelets and platelet assays. Now, because I'm a clinical microbiologist, I have to jump to chapter 7, otherwise I'm not here for a good reason. So it's looking at pneumococci and invasive pneumococcal disease, and you find this phage-derived protein, PBLB, plays an important role. So, I mean, they're present in 50% of the pneumococci. So as a clinical microbiologist, what do I need to do? Do I have to test for it, and what does it mean?
This is the way to move forward, I think, because what's interesting is a lot of genetic makeup of the bacteria has been looked at, but now we are also looking at a phage-derived gene, which is adding virus into the equation, let's say. So the way that the bacteria behaves, the way that they respond to their environment, that is phages, is also important. But I would say if you have a patient, then you are able to determine, based on the clinical isolate, what sort of progression of disease that they might have. I think that's a very important step.
So do I have to set up a PCR now, or what do I need to do tomorrow? I have to set it up, and will it have impact on the
patient? Well, you have to hire a very good person who knows a lot about it. That's one thing. So you obtain clinical sample, and then you have isolation of the pneumococcal strain, and then from there on it's actually a targeted, it can be an array of different risk factors that have been found. This is just one, but maybe people doing this sort of research can also find association with different kind of phenotypical manifestation of the disease, because we look in 30-day mortality, but other complications can also be examined at.
Should it really already be part of routine clinical diagnostics, or do we need to do a bit more studies? I mean, what will it mean for the patient if we say, okay, it's a pneumococcus, and this is Yeah, of course, it's present or not.
Yeah, of course, it's very early. We are now looking at one gene with one sort of complication. There are other more actually specific questions. We want to know whether, for example, PBLB, because we found it to be related to heightened platelet activation, whether that would lead to increased cardiovascular diseases, myocardial infarction, stroke. Just so the particular vascular thrombotic events, we would want to have a prospective study if we really want to look at these outcomes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Wertheim. The defense is hereby concluded. I give the floor once again to the candidate.
Having defended my doctoral thesis to the best of my ability, I would like to thank the rector and my supervisors, as well as those who have honored this ceremony with their presence.
The doctoral examination board retreats for its deliberations. The Council of Deans of Radboud University Nijmegen has decided to award you the degree of doctor. I invite Professor van der Ven to discharge the task assigned to him.
In the name of the Lord, and with the power entrusted by law of the Council of Deans, I declare hereby confer upon you Rahajeng Tunjungputri, born in Jakarta, the title of doctor from Radboud University Nijmegen, to which I attest all the associated legal and customary rights and duties with respect to academia and society. As proof thereof, I present you with this doctoral diploma signed by the rector and the doctoral thesis supervisors and co-supervisor.
Please take your seat. For the Laudatio, the floor is for Professor van der Ven, the first promoter.
Dr. Tunjungputri, always nice and a great honor to be able to be the first person to address you with this title, but in your case in particular. It has been a very long journey, and you made it, and you deserve it. Today is a day to celebrate, but it's also a sad element. Your mother is not here, and she is looking at this ceremony in a live stream. I hope she could hear everything well, and we can say she has a daughter to be very proud of. But now, Ajeng, you came to Nijmegen in 2007, so it's now 10 years ago. So that's a really long journey. You were selected by Professor Hussein, who has a very good nose of selecting the really bright people. Without what he's saying, KKP or PPK or whatever. there's an Indonesian set, but he is doing a very good job in that way. He always selects people who are outstanding. And at that time, you also met Monique Keuter as a block coordinator, and you also met Quirijn de Mast because he was the tutor in your group. And I think having contact with both of them, that really made your future, because both were extremely impressed by you. You were bright, as we heard today, pinter is an Indonesian word, a very pinter lady, and also very interactive, as maybe the audience has noticed also. So Monique became a kind of a model for you, a female internist, infectious disease specialist. So that is what you decided you wanted to become. Hussein was not the only one who noticed your qualifications and your qualities. So you made a small deviation, going to the genetic department. But in the end of the day, you came back to the infectious diseases, because when Rahajeng has something in her head, she really goes for it. So the last 4 years you have been at our department, and you really developed yourself further. Somebody is overseeing the big landscape of the research, but also slowly getting more into the nitty-gritty details, which are extremely important. And I think Quirijn and you especially tuned many times on the little nitty-gritty details. In the beginning, you were kind of, as an Indonesian student, when the professor speaks, you have to be quiet. But as the time develops, you became accustomed to our routines, that everybody talks, and you become an essential part of what we had, the platelet planet meetings. You discussed, you gave your inputs to everybody who was there, also the young people who came to work on the platelets. So you became, and you turned out to be, a very intelligent lady, unconventional, I would say outspoken, hard at her tongue, sharp, but with great humor, able to laugh, sometimes also to cry. So showing emotions, which, well, once in a while we come in Java, especially West Java, that's rather uncommon to show such emotions. Anyway, it may have triggered what you have stated, unsolicited psychoanalysis. And that's by an untrained therapist.
For free.
That's very dangerous. The frustrations of the therapist might be convened into the other person. So I would say to Professor Hussein, if she goes back to Indonesia and you find that she has some kind of remarkable behavior, you can always blame the untrained therapist for this. So we have seen many patients or many PhDs from abroad, from many countries. And I would say you are an outstanding person. I would say together with a person who is called Kibiki. He is now a professor in Tanzania, and he has a very high position in East Africa. As him, you are also a very strong woman, not only very intelligent, but also determined. If you want something, it will surely happen. It's called stamina. Endurance is enormous. In Indonesia, there's a saying, you cannot move a mountain. I think Rahajeng can. Anyway, so I think there's a bright future in front of you. As Monique and Quirijn might have been role models for you, you will be for others. Last night we were sitting with Professor Sample, and we talked. He talked about women in science in Sweden, and they had the right of priority because they are underrepresented in science. I think for you in Indonesia, this is not needed. And you are also not alone. I think you are a very good company. Professor Sultana, who is sitting in the audience, she is also a very strong lady who proved to be a very successful researcher in Indonesia. So I think the future for you, I hope it looks very bright. I hope there will be many opportunities for a postdoc. As Professor De Groot said, many people pass a PhD, but it doesn't mean that everybody will continue or has the capacity to go on with research independently. And we all agreed that you have the capacity of doing so. So we hope to keep in contact with you, and we can often elaborate more on the work we have been doing. So my congratulations are, of course, not only for you, also for your family, your husband-to-be. I guess that he is watching now. I think he knew what kind of a woman to expect, but maybe has some better insight now. And the final thing I would like to say is that the doctoral thesis is called Platelets in Infectious Disease, the Silent Force. I think the silent force is not applying to the one who wrote this, and I hope we hear from you many more. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the College of Deans, I congratulate you with this title, and the congratulations I also for your family, for here and far away, for your colleagues and friends here in the audience, and of course the supervisory team. I wish you a very good day today to celebrate this ceremony. And I wish you a lot of success in your further career. We conclude now, and we will do that, confirm the tradition of this university with a prayer. Gratias tibi atimus, omnipotens Deus, pro omnibus beneficiis tuis, qui vivis et regnas per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen.